practical knowledge of the tool and material. So, you know, they are out there doing stuff in the weeds. And, you know, they also have a theoretical understanding of, you know, what's possible, what can be done. So they have some sort of, they have like a good balance between the practical and the theoretical knowledge, so to speak. But if you look at the, you know, what constitutes, you know, a data scientist, or, you know, what exactly, where exactly does it lie in the periphery of known disciplines these days? So I think it's important for to think of it as three pillars of, you know, data science, so to speak. And data science typically lies at the intersection of all these disciplines. So first of all, in order to, you know, extract meaning from the data, you have to have some substantive expertise in the area that you are working at. So that means like the domain knowledge has to be there. So you should know the profession or that you are in. If you are using stuff in biology and doing some experiments and, you know, gathering some data and then doing some work on it, you know, doing some data, you know, data processing on it, then it's important that, you know, you should know that, you know, what is the physical nature of this data, you know, what the data is trying to tell you, what are the parameters of it, you know, what are the bounds of it, and so on and so forth. At the same time, you know, since I picked up the example of, you know, a biologist, I think it's important that, you know, a biologist typically lies in the traditional research domain here. So at the same time, they have to have like some sort of a knowledge of, you know, elementary knowledge of math and statistics. At least they should know, you know, what they are doing with the data that they are gathering. If you just take away the expertise domain completely and just talk about a little bit coding skills, which is represented as the pink circle here, and coupled with mathematics and statistics knowledge, and that's the domain of machine learning. I mean, these individuals who possess these skills, you know, they may or may not have some expertise in the domain, but they do have a generic knowledge of, you know, coding, but, you know, also specialized knowledge of mathematics, and coupled with that, they are able to make models and develop them and fine tune them and so on and so forth. Obviously, you don't want to be in the domain of like hacking skills coupled with substantive expertise. That means, you know, without mathematics as a tool, you know, you could be asking arbitrary unmute. Questions from your data.
Unmute.
Am I muted? Can you hear me? So the idea is to not be in this danger zone where, you know, you are arbitrarily asking questions without, you know, mathematics or statistics knowledge. But I think a right balance of all these three domains gives rise to a discipline of data science. Another way of looking at it, it's a recent science, I mean, which has only been facilitated by, you know, large amount of data. But, you know, science as we know it has been around for quite a while. But the conventional understanding of science has been, you know, empirical. That means, you know, observational stuff, that things that we see, the things that we feel around us, you know, that gives us a sense of, you know, the constraints of the physical world around us, and that is interpreted as, you know, some sort of an observational or empirical science. You know, if we see that, you know, ball goes towards the floor, then, you know, the concept of gravity is sort of like immortalized in that sense. So that's empirical in nature. Within the 18th century and even prior to that, like 16th, 17th century, you know, with the advent of mathematical tools like calculus and whatnot, there was a huge explosion in, like, you know, practicing science from a theoretical perspective. So basically, you know, you hypothesize a phenomenon, and then you know you describe it using you know some set of rules or some set of you know understanding that you can codify it in form of equations and whatnot, and it basically paved the way of you know new sort of understanding. And not only it was you know able to explain what you know people have already seen, but it was able to predict on what people have already seen and you know conjecture and you know establish some conjectures which were later proven from empirical point of view. So I think both of these disciplines went hand in hand. A more recent one which gained traction around in the era of like 1950s or so was the advent of you know computational science, where basically you know some of the physical phenomenon that was being described was so intractable to solve by hand that you know there were just like no solutions available. So you know what do you do in case of then? Well, I mean you deploy you know computing power. You start out with some set of initial conditions and you know some set of governing equations, and then you basically just let the system evolve and you obtain your solutions. I mean these are, of course, I mean there are considerations of stability and whatnot, but you know computational science has proven itself as a invaluable tool in the recent years, and it has actually you know so far it has firmly established itself as a third pillar of you know among the empirical and the theoretical science. But you know these are you know pretty much set and established you know way of practicing science, I mean discipline. So where does the data science fit in? And that's where the fourth paradigm of science, I mean as I like to see it, the data science comes in. So the idea is that you don't start with a hypothesis, you know, I mean everything is acceptable. What you take a look at is just you just collect the data, you know, arbitrarily, without any you know conjectures or hypotheses in your head. So in a sense, it kind of reverses the conventional approach to science, you know. But then you mine the data, and the data has to be massive, because you know it's statistics will tell you that it's really easy to get fooled by you know, small amounts of data and you know make assumptions that don't follow the rule of generality, so to speak. So in this kind of profession or this kind of discipline, the hypothesis is actually derived from mining massive data sets. So this in itself, the data itself is a central element to it. I mean there's no observations to begin with. Well, I mean there is only data collections of that kind of observations. In a sense, it is similar to what empirical science is, but it is just way too much big to be processed by you know a human just by taking a look at it. So you know coupled with computational, theoretical, and empirical, it sort of encapsulates everything, but it just sort of reverses the conventional approach to practicing the science. So how does it fit in the enterprise? I mean, so I've been stressing enough that you know it's all about the analysis of data, and there has to be some sort of an automation involved some sort of automation or some sort of semi-automation involved with the extraction of knowledge from massive amounts of data. So you don't start out with a hypothesis, you let it build up from what you are seeing from the data. And the key thing that I would like to stress here is that, you know, the data has to be massive. Otherwise, you know, people can just fool themselves on that front. So what are the takeaway messages that, you know, an enterprise, when, you know, the data is massive, what considerations that one needs to take care of? I think if you were to memorize it, I would like to say that, you know, there are like three V's of enterprise data science. First of all, it's the volume of data. How much data do you have? The number of rows that you have in your data set, objects or bytes, you know, just the sheer volume, the bulkiness of it. The other V is variety. You know, how many features do you have? How much orthogonal information does the data bring in? In linear algebra terms, I mean, are these like you know, are these dependent upon each other, or you know, or this these are completely orthogonal features that you are taking a look at. And also not only, you know, so these two things, volume and variety, they give you a sense of two dimensions on, you know, the bulkiness and the features as such. But I think that it's equally important that in the modern world, we need to take a look at, or we need to understand, you know, the velocity of the data. That the, because most of the phenomena, in even in the business side, that is happening so much real time, that the data is coming not as form of a batch, but as a continuous stream. So you have to have like considerations on what's the rate at I can, you know, my systems that I design, you know, the algorithms that I design, or the solutions that I design take into consideration the just the sheer pace at which the data is coming at towards the system. And a little bit tentatively, I would like to say that, you know, the veracity of the data, although I don't consider it as a strong part of the V family, but it's just like the authenticity of the data. I mean, is it just garbage, or can we, you know, really trust it? So those sort of considerations are beyond the, just by the, you know, the at the scale, I would say, you know, this doesn't, the veracity doesn't quite fit in the scale, scaling of the, picture as such. So let's talk about, you know, data models. Just I'm shifting gears completely. So you know, all this time I was trying to build a case for the data science discipline, you know, what it is. But the key takeaway here is that, you know, we got to do things at scale. So a data model is central to the discipline of data science, because it actually determines that how you are consuming it and how do you write your algorithms around it. Okay. So what are the key elements of the data models? It has to have some sort of a structure to it. You know, if the data is in a tabular format, it has to have like rows and columns and so forth. If you're representing it as a graph, then it has to have like nodes and edges in it. If you're representing it as a dictionary of some sort, then it has to have like some key value pairs to it. So, you know, fairly simple, not so advanced concepts, just how you represent, how do you define relationships between the data itself. It has to have some sort of a constraints in it, right? So like, for instance, if you are dealing with a tabular data, so is there a constraint of all rows must have same number of columns, or they could be different, or those columns are not even defined for some of the data elements in your set? And do the columns have the same type? You know, are they numeric? Are they text? Are they intermixed? And so on and so forth. So the constraint portion basically, you know, gives you a sense of, you know, how is it, you know, what are the limits that, you know, this data can take form with. Then I think the most important point is, you know, what are the operations that you can define on this data? You know, so basically, for example, if you are given a key, you know, in a dictionary, that the operation supported could be find the value of key X, for that matter, right? And, you know, if you are given like a, you know, spreadsheet of some sort or a database of some sort, then basically you have to give all the rows where the first name could be Ramesh or Suresh or whatever. So I think the considerations about the structure, constraints and operations is important, you know, in choosing a data model. So just to give an example, I mean, these are all very theoretical exposition of, you know, data models as such. Just take a typical CSV file and or an Excel file. It is a data model, right? I mean, you say that, you know, you can represent the data in a tabular format, you can do some sort of an operations on it and so on and so forth, right? So, but it also defines, you know, the columns, what kind of data types they are, you know, it has everything in it, but I'm afraid that, you know, these are for only academic purposes only. So the reason why I say that is that, you know, dealing with these kinds of data models, you have to read everything into memory before performing any action on the data itself. And then naturally it is a solution that just becomes not scalable at an enterprise level. So what do? Classic solution, we do databases generally. I mean, so enterprise data has to have stored in database, which, you know, so databases on on a cursory level, they store data, but I think what sets them apart is that they have like optimized search and retrieval operations, right? So the good algorithms which have backing in theoretical solid theoretical backing, they have already been implemented in the database system, so that you don't have to write those algorithms in your system itself. I mean, you don't have to design those things from ground up, right? They come in different flavors, relational databases, right? SQL and Oracle. They support relational, language, SQL-like language, find all columns where this field matches this, something like that. It's very intuitive and so on and so forth. Generally, they have, a fixed columnar structure and each row may have like fixed number of columns with fixed data types and so on and so forth. So a schema is pretty well defined in those kind of relational databases. Then there is a concept of NoSQL databases, and this is typically used for like unstructured data. So you may or may not have like all the fields populated, and the fields may be like very disjoint from each other. So for example, Mongo, etc., those things are stored as a document. It's okay if you don't follow the stuff that I'm saying, because I understand the audience is a little general, but I think this would serve as a good starting point to read more about these things. And that's the only intent of it. And then we have like graph databases where we query the related entities. The basic point that I'm trying to drive home here is that all these operations, I mean, depending upon how the data interact, one element of data interacts with each other, it is important to make a choice of what kind of storage that you would be taking a look at, right? And that's where the difference lies among these two. But if you must store these things on a disk, then I would highly recommend that, you take a look at, some optimized file formats that are, available publicly and freely. And a couple of them are, I've listed here. The one is Apache Parquet, and the other one is Apache Avro. They have their own pros and cons. Sometimes you do actually, and the case for having, data on disk, but not in the database, is somehow having the static data set, which can, if you're like making models and stuff like that, you are able to version it that, I made this model using this specific data set. So it is reproducible. Enterprise databases change their state all the time. So it is very important to, have some, a static snapshot of that data within your, local machine or however you want to analyze it. So I think taking a look at these two file formats would really help you a lot. And I would say that, Apache Parquet is what I have, some experience with. Avro is what I haven't played with as such, because it is mostly used in the streaming data paradigm. Like when you have, a bunch of data coming in and you want to process it real time and so on and so forth. But most of my work has been in the domain of, batch processing and so on and so forth.
Dr. Ravi, come closer to your mic, actually.
Oh, okay. Okay. Is this better?
Yeah.
Okay. So now I just want to give a little flavor about, what kind of algorithms we use for, mining massive data sets. So obviously, parallelism is the way to go. Okay. So what's the general sense of, parallelizing algorithms? So in general, we want to reduce like polynomial time algorithms, which, scale as order of n square or n cube or n to the power 4 by number of workers. So the idea is that, you don't have one computer that is doing the job, but you have like multiple computers doing the job for you. Okay. So, and the number of computers here, I'm representing it as k. And for this particular purpose, I would say that, we are not even bothering ourselves with exponential time algorithms because they are too inefficient to begin with, right? So for example, I'm just giving you a simple example, a linear search. This is what I call it as embarrassingly parallel, right? So if you were to answer the question, is 72 present in this particular array or not? So what do you do? So you go element by element, and this is unsorted array, right? I mean, you go element by element, you see, say 8, is 8 equal to 72? No. 90 equal to 72? No. And you move on. So the in the worst case scenario, you would run until the end of the array to find your solution, right? And that's why I say that, you know, it scales as O of n. It scales linearly as number of elements with it, right? But the way that, you know, you can speed it up is that have maybe like three computers instead of one, and then partition your data, and you say that, okay, I'm going to send this data represented in yellow in computer one, this one is in computer two, this one in computer three, and then either if one of them gets a hit, so you basically, you know, say that, yeah, the element is present or the element is not present. But if you do this wisely, you know, keeping the number of the elements same in each of the chunk or approximately the same, you are basically reducing your work, at least the time, by a factor of k. I mean, the work remains the same, but the time is, you know, reduced as such. So, but there are like more complicated models, and I would just like to, you know, motivate some examples here. So, for example, sorting an array, right? I mean, there is a theoretical bound on it saying that it is a n log n, but can we do better in parallel? So for example, this is again an unsorted array. We have to sort it. How do we do this? So first of all, you know, I would like to introduce a basic algorithmic concept called MapReduce over here. So MapReduce, basically what it says is that, okay, anything less than equal to 30, for example, let me just pass it on to this particular worker one, okay, represented in yellow. So 8, 30, 25, 10, they are all less than equal to 30, they go here, okay? The other one, you can say that, you know, less than equal to 60, everything goes here, from 30 to, you know, 31 to 60, this is the green one, and the rest follows later, right? So what you are doing here is essentially not just blind. So over here, so basically you're not just blindly setting them to different workers, but you are making some sort of a decision based on what the characteristics of the data is. So think of it as like a quick sort partition for that matter, right? And once you have that, then you can do some, you can sort these elements in parallel by using any other sorting algorithms, merge sort, quick sort, whatever, and then you can bring it back. So that's the idea. First of all, you map data elements to different workers, and then you take the reduced model, and then you do the actual work. Another example: suppose you are given a set of documents, okay, and you know your job is to give a histogram of number of words. You know, how many times you see "fine" in all of these documents? How many times you see "top" in all of these documents? So the good idea is to basically take all of these things and have like a hashing function, you know, which basically uniquely maps each word to one given worker as such. So, you know, top gets mapped to worker one, D gets mapped to worker two, fine gets mapped to worker three, and then it becomes a straightforward operation that, you know, just sum the total number of times you saw the top and so on and so forth. So this is a very common approach in writing parallelized algorithms. But like I said, most of these things are already implemented for you. Right, I mean, this is just examples for your flavor and how they are implemented. So just let me give you a quick, you know, what's the industry standard on that. I think where I'm getting at is that you should be using more and more of parallel based frameworks like Apache Spark instead of Pandas. Okay, so Pandas is, you know, I would say the Excel of data science now. I mean, everybody who wants to practice, you know, data science as a profession should be very well versed with Pandas. It's you know, it's an open source tool. It's a very user-friendly APIs, but the problem is it is not parallel. It does eager execution, like holds everything in memory. It just evaluates the result for you immediately, and it is slow. Don't use it on scale. It will come back and hurt you. It's good for exploration, but no scaling application would really buy into the Pandas philosophy. Instead of that, use Apache Spark. It, you know, achieves high performance for both batch and streaming data. It has like a DAX scheduler. So basically what it does is, in essence, is that it does not do the actual computations straight away, but instead it memorizes that, you know, I have to go from data state one to data state two or three or four. I have to take these sequence of steps, and only when you ask for the result, it will actually perform the work. So it is very fast in that sense. and it does not store like egregious amounts of data into memory, and it would really never fail you. So, you know, this is something I cannot stress upon much. It has a query optimizer. It can run SQL queries on the data itself. I mean, you can treat your data in memory as like a SQL database. So if you are not very well versed with, say, let's say Spark API itself, you can run SQL commands on it. If you're coming from a database background, it can write, and you can write your programs in several different languages like Python, Java, and Scala and whatnot. And there is a recent hybrid thing in the off late that came out from Databricks company, and which is the Koalas, which basically takes Pandas user friendly API and tries to do some sort of mapping on Apache Spark. So I think I would recommend you guys to take a look at it if you are interested. Somebody is interested in having speeding up with their code with Pandas like APIs and so on and so forth. So just to give an example, this is the work that I recently did for my company. I'm not going to go into very specifics of it, what it was, but it was a very large model that we had to train. The data was coming from the database, which I have represented here. So we had to first download the data for training because of the static considerations and whatnot, that, you know, the data should be immutable and so on and so forth. But then whenever we were doing operations on the data, you know, people were using Pandas and it was a big mess. We transformed, rewrote the whole framework in Spark, and then we immediately are starting to reap the rewards of 35 times speed up of fetching the data to our local machines. And RAM savings are like enormous. You know, I can't stress this enough. This was amazing. And it can be used for both training and inference of the data, meaning once you have the model, you can do the inference on it. So with that, I'll move into the third section with the data science platform. And I think this is something which is important to stress from, if we are working in an industry or an enterprise. So it is ubiquitous at every big company who takes data science seriously. And data science platform in a nutshell is that they don't expect you to use personal computers or even company provided laptops to do your model training and whatnot. Obviously, these things are done in a server, but data science platform provide a sort of homogenized or level playing field for all developers. Meaning if you develop something, you can be sure that your colleague would be able to run it and so on and so forth, right? And the good thing about them is that they mirror closely to the production environment. So whatever you develop, once you basically package it together and provide it as a software solution for your company, you are absolutely sure that it would work because the platform is so close to the production environment that the chances of things going wrong would be really, really minimized. You don't have to do extra refactoring on that kind of stuff. So few elements that you should start practicing now, I would say, is that the code version control. And I'm sure most of you might have seen one flavor or the other. It's Git, SVN, or Mercurial. Basically, it takes a snapshot of your code. And then if you change something, and then you say that, okay, I changed this, commit this. So basically, it will compute the delta between the code. What has changed? What has changed going from one state of code to the other? So it is a very powerful tool to track changes. Trust me, you will really love developing once you're introduced to Git and whatnot. At the same time, I think this is more esoteric right now, but data version control is also very important. If you have the same code, but on different data sets, it is performing differently, then I think it's important for you to take charge of versioning your data, that I downloaded this data on this particular day, this data on that particular day, and so on and so forth. And has the same code giving me different, is the same code giving me different answers here and there, right? So, but I think more than the data version control, pay attention to the code version control. That is more important. Containerization is another thing. So basically, you don't have to deal with the dependency mess a whole lot. Your code and dependencies live together in an isolated environment. And the technologies that you can read about is called Docker. Then we have CI/CD pipelines. So basically, once you automate the process of your code is ready, and then basically you say, okay, all good. And you say, I'm going to, you know, send the code somewhere, let's say hypothetically, to a server, and the server automatically triggers a build, builds your code, builds your executable, and then just basically deploy it. So everything is a streamline, everything is automatic. You don't have to take the executable and put it in some other environment. So on and so forth. So those sort of things. And then the last, containerized workload management. And you can read about Kubernetes. Basically, if you have more than one, it basically boils down to how many requests that you are getting for this particular model, right? I mean, let's say your model is behind a website which is driving some real-time decisions and so on and so forth, and 10 people log in. Okay, so maybe one container, one instance of that website is good. But then let's say if 1,000 people log in, what do? You have to scale that the whole thing up. And I think those sort of automations are provided by containerized workload management solutions. You can read about Kubernetes on that front. Just a general thing about the code quality, that once you write code, there should be, these are computational experiments, right? I mean, they should be very well documented. You should be using Jupyter notebooks with graphs and supporting tables to support your hypothesis alongside with the code that generates that. And, I've provided several links, and I will send a link out to this, the slide deck also, so you are able to follow and whatnot. Do check out Google Colab, which is a co-laboratory option from the Google. And I think it allows you to do Python-based notebook really, for free and whatnot. And also, the raw data, you should not make any changes to it. Use data pipelines, just a simple thing. And reuse code as much as possible, write libraries, and packages if you're doing in Python. And, follow general advice from, data science project organization. How do you basically lay out everything, your data, your code, how do they interact and so on and so forth. I think a lot has been talked about. And frankly, I'm not the best person. I actually follow their advice. So please do take a look at it if you get a chance. Just quick things about containerization. Why do we do even containerization? So for example, if you have worked in Python, so let's say you wanna run some code, you wanna use some libraries, it says, okay, you gotta install these libraries. You do an install, and then that install basically just messes up another install. And it's just like a dependency hell that you get into it. So I think this meme sums it better. That dependency says, I failed to resolve, and you say, okay, resolve it again. Fail to resolve, you just go over and over again, and you're like, what's going on? So containerization is it's a new concept. Think of it as a virtual machine, but not quite a virtual machine, because it takes away the additional work of housing a guest OS on top of your native operating system. But it basically just packages your codes and with their binaries and libraries in an isolated environment, so that two different models don't interact with each other, and those dependencies are not problematic with each other. Workflow orchestration is the last bit. So basically, that's what I was trying to say. Let's say you have applications, okay? And let's say you have like a number of users which are calling in, that saying that, okay, give me this answer. I want this answer for 10 persons or 1,000 persons and so on and so forth. So you need to have some sort of a load balancer, which basically spawns up each instance of this application, with binaries and whatnot. And it serves it back so that, you are able to scale up, corresponding to the number of requests and so on and so forth. And there is a whole different philosophy of deploying models as a service and so on and so forth. I'm not going to go into much more detail on that. So I think if you want to know more about it, I think, I've just briefly mentioned that Kubernetes cluster is one approach, but you should also take a look at, Amazon Web Services and Google Cloud Platform. And I think GCP is pretty much free for, I think if there are any geographic restraints, I apologize in advance, because at least from the USA, they give you like $300 worth of compute time to do that stuff. So if you are able to access it for free, make sure that you check it out if you are interested in it. So just wrapping up, how do you play a role in the data science? Okay, so if you are a statistician, okay, you need to learn with data that does not fit into memory. Obviously, you have to learn the tricks and trade at least at the very least learn about libraries that you know who can parallelize data efficiently for you, like Spark and so on and so forth. If you are a software engineer, if you have a background in just computer science, classical computer science, you do need to learn statistical modeling. You don't want to get into that danger zone that I was talking about previously. Okay, if you are a database administrator, you need to learn to deal with unstructured data. And if you are a business analyst, then you should, you know, need to learn about the algorithms and trade-offs at scale. Okay, what's possible and what's not possible. So what have I learned so far? I think, you know, I didn't possess a computer science background. So most of the learning is still ongoing. So I would say that, you know, study of algorithms, if you are a computer science student, that is paramount. Please, please, please pay attention to discrete mathematics courses and algorithms courses if they are taught at university, okay? Data science, again, it's a very hands-on discipline. It requires a lot of practice and you will fail many times. 100 times you will fail, maybe one time you'll succeed, and that too, that success will be short-lived. You'll have to come back and revise everything what you have done because it just moves so fast-paced, okay? If you want to learn more about it, make a study group with, you know, people who you know, share the passion for, you know, learn more and more. Read and discuss, you know, blog posts from companies like Google, Brain, Microsoft Research and whatnot. It's just new research is already pouring in from different dimensions and it's hard to keep up. But I think, you know, first get some broad idea about, you know, what the discipline is and what kind of things are present. Then specialize in something like computer vision and anything that you want. Like if you want to do visualizations, that's fine. If you want to do model building, that's fine as well. You know, if you want to do just systems modeling, and that's fine as well. But have a general sense of, you know, where the entire, you know, scientific discipline is going. Okay. So that's it for now. Sorry for taking all this time. I think I've overshot by 15 minutes, but I'll take any questions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Amrinder और दीपक, कोई अगर सवाल पूछना चाहता है हिंदी या इंग्लिश में, उन बच्चों से कह सकते हैं they can ask questions.
Okay, sir. Thank you. It was a very nice session. Now I would request to all the participants, if anyone want to ask any question, you can ask either in Hindi as well as in English, whatever you feel. Is anyone? You can unmute yourself. First, you unmute yourself, then you can ask it.
Sir, can you tell something more about Apache?
And first of all, tell about yourself.
Myself, Tarang Jain from Motilal Nehru College, Delhi University. I want to know something more about Apache.
Okay.
So Apache is, I believe it's a free software foundation now, if I'm not mistaken, which has many products in their arsenal. I think most of the very common product that, you know, you might have seen or heard about is called Hadoop. It's what, like the distributed file systems stuff that they came out with back in the days when, you know, they were still, I think, with Yahoo and whatnot. But I think it's an excellent resource of, you know, maintaining, which supports like open software stuff. So Apache is just like, you know, think of it as the open source company which promotes you know, open source software. So their products are, you know, Hadoop is one, like I said, Spark is the whole you know, analytical framework for doing machine learning and handling big data and stuff like that. And I think one of the deep learning frameworks that they provide is MXNet, that is like heavily used in Amazon. So do you have like a specific question on which product of theirs that you are interested in, or is it just generally like?
Actually, you told about Pandas and you said that Panda is no more that much useful as compared to Apache. I want to know the comparison for that.
Oh, okay. So Apache Spark is what I was referring to. So first of all, okay, let me backtrack a little. I mean, maybe I just got carried away and said that Pandas is no more useful. That's a lie. don't believe that. Pandas is still useful in day-to-day activity, right? I mean, it is a very powerful and mature tool, and you should definitely use it, okay? People would expect you to use it and know about it, okay? But the situation when it fails is like when when you are dealing with such large amount of data sets, so that it cannot hold everything into memory at one go. Okay, so such a huge big data set that you try to load it in and it just crashes the program itself, and that's where we have a problem. And in within the distributed environment also, let's say you have like two or three different computers, hypothetically, ideally you would have like a large cluster. In that environment also, I mean, Pandas is not written inherently to have like multi-worker communications built in, right? I mean, if you want to, chop the jobs, saying that aap chahte hain ki, one third of my job goes to one server and the other one third goes to other server and so on and so forth, and then I will collect the data finally. Pandas is just not capable of doing that. So in a big and massive data ecosystem, I think Pandas is slow, and it will cause massive memory problems. And that's where like Spark shines. That was the point that I was trying to convey. But don't be under a misimpression that Pandas is not useful. If you go for an interview, people will still ask you Pandas questions. So do read Pandas and take it seriously.
Okay, so you are talking about parallel processing. My next mm-hmm. question is related to that only. Mm-hmm. You have taken an example of linear searching where you have used parallel processing. You have divided the data into three parts. Mm-hmm. But suppose IC72 exists three times in our data. It may happen that in the second slot, it is occurring in the last of the second slot, but in the third slot, it is occurring at the starting of the data. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we will not be able to get the first occurrence of the element we are looking for, isn't it?
I think the question here was, does 72 exist in this data set or not? So I think you should still be able to get an answer. I mean, if the true flag gets raised by either of these workers, then you are good, right? I mean, let's say 72 exists.
First occurrence of 72, then is it possible using this parallel processing or not?
Yeah, definitely it should be possible.
Okay.
Can you tell me the pitfalls of the data science?
Pitfalls of the data science. Well, I would say it. I mean, the only thing that I can think of is, data can fool you. I think
because
you have to be really, we are really.
The student of science, we should need to know.
Sure. So data can fool you, and I've seen it many times. It has fooled me. It has fooled my colleagues. We were thinking that, it is telling us one story, but, actually that was not the case. So I think and the best advice that I can give you is that any hypothesis has to have, solid grounding in statistics and mathematics. So if you are not an expert, then please do in some cases that where you really feel that you don't have a confidence or a good handle of the understanding of this on this particular problem, do get in touch with a statistician. It is really, really important that you do so. Otherwise, like I said, you get into the territory of danger zone. The more you lose your backing from mathematics and statistics and move away from it, then you just have you could be an expert in the domain knowledge and you can be an expert in writing codes and whatnot, but that would really give you problems. So yeah, you can tell selective stories based on data. I mean this is also like a big problem in academic circles, right? I mean, you can choose data points as such that that support your hypothesis. So but in Yeah, like I said, always, always
Dr. question Dr. Amrind, sir, I have a question.
Dr. Amrind, after this question, I think we should call Dr. Professor Puneet Mishra.
Dr. Puneet. Okay, sir.
Take one question of Dr. K.K. Shukla.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Bhadauria, sir, are you listening?
Yes, I'm listening.
If you remember, initially you have given a model. There are three skills you have. Mathematics and statistical skills and substantive skills. Relevance of data science and all these things. So I'm not aware of your, this computer science, but I have a very small doubt. I'm interested in the hacking skills. Because I'm seeing on the left-hand side of the screen, there's a caption written that the site is not secure. Still, we are using. Initially, our college had so many reservations. हमको लग रहा था कहीं हैक ना हो जाए
रवि हैकिंग का रवि बिकॉज नंबर ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स आर लिसनिंग यू राइट नाउ दे आर द बीएससी स्टूडेंट्स बिकॉज वी आर ऑफरिंग कंप्यूटर साइंस इन बीएससी ओनली सो यू शुड बी बाइलिंगुअल इन दिस पर्टिकुलर क्वेश्चन
ओके ओके सो हैकिंग स्किल्स यहां पे
नहीं दैट Your connection to this site is not fully secure. There is a caption on the left. And one line written, attackers might be able to see the images you are looking at modifying them. So, normal human being, or as a journalist, I am not aware of it. But as a technical expert, this line and the security of this site and all.
तो इसमें देखिए हैकिंग स्किल्स से मेरा यही तात्पर्य था कि मतलब ये कोडिंग को लेके था कि मतलब आपकी कंप्यूटर साइंस की चीजें मतलब स्ट्रांग होनी चाहिए और हैकिंग का जो टर्म यहाँ पे जो यूज करते हैं वो जनरली ये रहता है कि जुगाड़ टाइप्स है राइट तो मतलब आपकी प्रॉब्लम सॉल्विंग यूजिंग द कंप्यूटर साइंस शुड बी लाइक सॉलिड मतलब यू कैन राइट गुड कोड And you can, you know, make things work. So that उतना ही context था. It was
sir,
not.
Zoom तो लिख के दे रहा. Zoom में लिखा हुआ है. Attackers might be able to see images you are looking. लिखा हुआ बाय तरफ. You know, the warning है. They have given the warning. Not secure. So आप चूंकि expert आप हमको ये बताएं कि हम ऐसी security अच्छा platform में we are using it frequently. Please.
तो वो तो जिन्होंने लिखा है. उसको वही बता पाएंगे
बिकॉज दे आर ऑल्सो इन्वॉल्व इन द डेटा माइनिंग आई हैव हर्ड अबाउट दे आर डूइंग द सेम प्रैक्टिस दे आर इन्वॉल्व इन डेटा माइनिंग दैट्स व्हाई दिस साइट इज नॉट सिक्योर दे आर फैसिलिटेटिंग कुकीज ऑल्सो Will you please?
इसमें मैं क्या मतलब इसमें तो ये तो मोस्टली ये मतलब क्रिप्टोग्राफी और इन सब टाइप की चीजों पे चला जाएगा मामला उसमें तो कतई एक्सपर्टीज नहीं है मेरी बट मैं यही कहना चाह रहा था कि जो हैकिंग का यहाँ पे जो कॉन्टेक्स्ट है हैकिंग का कॉन्टेक्स्ट यहाँ पे ये है कि आप कंप्यूटर के मतलब जो आप कोडिंग जो है आपकी वो सॉलिड होनी चाहिए उस चीज पे उससे आगे मतलब उससे आगे आप उस पे मतलब देयर इज नॉट मोर टू रीड इनटू इट देन जस्ट यू नो जस्ट द कोडिंग पार्ट दैट्स द आइडिया एंड यू कैन सॉल्व प्रॉब्लम्स बेस्ड ऑन कोडिंग बट कन्वेंशनल हैकिंग जैसे आप हम लोग समझ रहे हैं राइट कि मतलब मैन इन द मिडिल टाइप के अटैक और ये सब टाइप की चीजें कोई देख सकता है आप जो यू नो कम्युनिकेशन कर रहे हैं उस टाइप से उस पे कॉन्टेक्स्ट नहीं है यहाँ पे राइट तो तीन पिलर हैं इस चीज पे मैं ये कहना चाह रहा था कि एक तो आपकी कोडिंग शुड बी टिप टॉप देन द अदर थिंग शुड बी कि आपका मैथमेटिक्स और स्टैटिस्टिकल नॉलेज अच्छे से होना चाहिए राइट और जिस डोमेन में आप हैं तीसरी चीज में राइट आई मीन जिस प्रोफेशन में आप हैं राइट जैसे कि मैं हेल्थ केयर इंडस्ट्री में हूँ तो मुझे उसका आइडिया होना चाहिए कि क्या चल रहा है वहां पे ठीक है, जो कि यू नो ऑटोमेटेड ड्राइविंग की इंडस्ट्री में है, उनको ये आइडिया होना चाहिए कि वहाँ पे उस एरिया में क्या एडवांसेस हैं और वो सारी चीजें. तो वो डोमेन नॉलेज कपल्ड विथ कोडिंग स्किल्स जो कि यहाँ पे हैकिंग से रिप्रेजेंट किया हुआ है, और मैथमेटिक्स और स्टेटिस्टिकल नॉलेज, ये तीन चीजें आपका कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बनाती हैं पूरा डेटा साइंस का. जब तक आप तीनों की कमांड नहीं हासिल करते एक तरीके से वन वे और द अदर, तब तक आप मतलब डेटा साइंस को उतने 100% एक्यूरेसी के साथ प्रैक्टिस नहीं कर पा रहे. दैट्स द जिस्ट ऑफ दिस वन.
In short,
Dr. Amrin, please, I think we should move to the another expert, and I request Ravi Badoria ki hum second unko sun lete hain, uske baad then we'll come to the next step of the webinars thereafter. We'll keep in touch with us.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, Dr. Ravi Badoria, to enlightening the concepts of deep concept of data science. Thank you once again, and now we would like to continue our session with another reputed speaker, Dr. Puneet Mishra. Dr. Puneet Mishra achieved his Doctor of Philosophy from University of Lucknow. At present, he is working as an assistant professor in Department of Computer Science, University of Lucknow. Dr. Puneet Mishra has published number of research papers in various refereed and reputed journals. His area of specialization is artificial intelligence, machine learning, and web technologies. And now I request to our speaker, Dr. Puneet Mishra, to kindly express his ideas over the topic. Dr. Puneet Mishra, over to you, sir.
Thanks, Amrinder ji. I'm sharing my screen. That screen is correct there?
Yes, sir. Sir.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Okay.
Perfect.
So it was a nice lecture from Ravi sir. He had expressed all his wisdom about data science, and being a novice, I'm starting from a beginner's approach. I know that there are students as well as faculty members from different streams, so I'll take a little bit easier. What about data science? So the basic thing I've start with is the common buzzwords of recent computer science domain include artificial intelligence, data science, business analytics, deep learning. There are n number of words, but the basic theme of this data science was actually came up with the origin of artificial intelligence. And this term was first coined by John McCarthy in 1956 in a conference named as Dartmouth Conference, USA, and where he coined this word artificial intelligence. And from there, it was started using all across the globe. So his first aim was to give the concept of thinking machines, which have certain capabilities like automata theory, complex information processing, cybernetics. These were the part of initially artificial intelligence. But after six or eight decades later, artificial intelligence is now perceived to be a subfield of computer science, where computer systems are developed to perform tasks that would typically demand human intervention. Now these include decision making, speech recognition, translation between languages, as well as visual perceptions. In more simpler words, I will say that nowadays artificial intelligence is utilized in approximately various areas, various streams, like vision. You see the camera photo in which it detects your photo on the screen and tags you there. So that is the basic thing. And later on, when artificial intelligence took its more powerful form, certain tentacles or certain branches of it came out of it. The basic branch which I work is machine learning. And when I talk about machine learning, it is a artificial intelligence branch, where a class of data-driven algorithms enable software applications to become highly accurate in predicting outcomes without any need for explicit programming. So you don't need now to have programs, but you can predict something. So the prediction and forecasting, I'll come about these in later. So that is the basic aim of machine learning. The basic premise here is to develop algorithms that can receive input data and leverage statistical models to predict an output while updating outputs as new data becomes available. Now, the processes involved have a lot in common with predictive modeling and data mining. This is because both approaches demand one to search through the data to identify patterns and adjust the program accordingly. So another branch came along with machine learning that is also known as data mining. Now, till now we have all learned about various machine learning algorithms and we utilize it in one form or another. And where we use, like in Amazon, or if you watched a movie on Netflix. Now these personalized product or movie recommendations are machine learning in action. So that is another thing. Now, another buzzword came out of it. I'm talking about is data science. Now this data science can be described as the description, prediction, and causal inference from both structured and unstructured data. Now this discipline helps individuals and enterprises make better business decision making. So everything revolves around better decision making ability. And for that, you have to analyze data you have. These are certain examples from where we are getting data. And data nowadays, enormous data things are there. When we talk about enormous data things, like we can get data from historical archives, sensors. Nowadays, we talk about IoT, Internet of Things. This is based on sensors and from household data to any organization data that can be based on sensors and that can be treated as input, physiology, and there are other data sets also. Now, what this fascinating world of data, a lot of data is being collected and warehoused, like in scientific experiments, Internet of Things, web data, e-commerce, financial transactions, bank credit transactions, online trading and purchasing, and there are n number of things. A major thing is social networks. Other things are stocks, sales, goods consumptions, images, DNA sequencing, handwritten character recognition. These produce a lot of data. And because of a lot, this huge nature of data, we have to go into certain algorithms to derive certain conclusions from these. Now, what to do with these data? We can do aggregation and statistics, like we can use data warehousing and online analytical processing, indexing, searching, and querying. This can be keyword-based search, pattern matching, XML, and RDF-based. Knowledge discovery, we can use data mining, statistical modeling, then data driven like predictive analytics, deep learning. These are the basic things which we have to do with data. Now, when we talk about data, there are a lot of things comes into our mind. Why data science? Earlier there was no data science, still we are doing things, but why data science? And another term which I used earlier was forecasting and prediction. These are the two terms which we are more interested. But there's a huge gap between forecasting and prediction. When we talk about forecasting, it is a calculation or estimate of future events or trends based on scientific means. That is data gathering and statistical analysis. Forecast deals in time sensitive is specifics. Forecasting may be either quantitative, that is based on numerical data, or it can be either qualitative in nature. And it can be based on context and usage, that is weather forecasting we can take, socio-economic business forecasting we can take, science research and modeling forecasting we can do. But when we talk about prediction, prediction is something different than forecasting. More of the times, people use these terms related to each other. But a prediction is a more general statement. Declaration or indication of future events, developments or trends based on history, observation, deduction, instinct, or arrived at by means of techniques, that is psychic deviations. Context and usage is mainly important for prediction-based analysis. Any commonly practiced in media industry like news and sports commentator, pollsters, and in the betting industry, it can be utilized. It is strongly associated with astrology, tarot, or esoteric, that is psychic discipline. This can be utilized. So the problem again comes. I talked about machine learning, I talked about data science, but still the picture is not clear. Forecasting, I talked about forecasting, prediction, but what is data science? Still, we are unable to discuss this. Now, when we talk about data science is the need of the hour, and it has become a necessity for each and every organization. Companies require data to function, grow, and improve their businesses. But a basic question comes into mind before going for. Why is it that data science has suddenly become so important that no company or any sector can do without it? And the answer is data. The ridiculous amount of data that is being generated by humans and machines can help companies to take better decisions. And the decisions could be about improving a product or a service or a launch or of a new product or service. I have one thing in mind. I'm telling about the quote of management guru Peter Drucker, who has said that most decisions taken by managers are mostly affected by the reasons that either the required data is not available or not as per the requirement. In all the cases, the decision making is tough, not as per the need of the organization. Data scientists deal with the data in order to assist companies in making proper decisions. The data-driven approaches undertaken by the companies with the help of data scientists who analyze a large amount of data to derive meaningful insights. Now, these insights will be helpful for the companies who wish to analyze themselves and their performance in the market. Other than commercial industries, healthcare, there are different domains or segments where we are using data science nowadays. Where the technology is in huge demand to recognize microscopic tumors, deformites, as well as diabetic prediction at an early stage of diagnosis. So data science is basically a science to handle with data. But another question arises here. There are certain traditional databases already available. Then why to go into that? The traditional databases are not sufficient to handle this kind of data which we are generating nowadays. And the traditional analysis techniques are not sufficient to analyze the data. The data science, therefore, is a solution if the companies want valuable insight from the data they have, and to find this insight and valuable information from a large data set, it is like finding a needle in a haystack. And the knowledge of statistics is not sufficient only to do that. There's another thing. I've utilized the word statistics. So I'm in the opinion, being a computer scientist, that there has always been a duel between the approximate science persons and exact science persons. And statistics being a approximation science, they tried to figure out this computer techniques to form this data science domain. So when we talk about the data science definition, we have one definition here: an area that manages, manipulates, extracts, and interprets knowledge from tremendous amount of data. It is a multidisciplinary field of a study with goal to address the challenges in big data. And data science principles apply to all data, whether it is either big or small. And to handle data science, we have data scientists. So there are no such basic there are no such basic characteristics of these data scientists. But the data scientists, apart from being experts in mathematics, statistics, programming, machine learning, these are also experts in scientific domain they work. That means initial domain knowledge as well as these subject knowledge is also required. But this cannot be the properties of a single person. So when we talk about this data science, we work in groups. Some statisticians help us, some mathematicians help us, and some domain knowledge helps us, some computer science person helps us, and then we come to the concluding this data science domain problem. Now, when we talk about data science, it is like a forensic science. And data scientists are forensic scientists, since they look for clues and patterns using techniques only known to them from the amount of data only they can manage. So that means there are certain clues which they know, and the data, the huge amount of data, only they can handle. And just like forensic scientists look for motive for any crime that has been committed, data scientists look for a reason why and what needs to be done, more than how it is supposed to be done. So in my opinion, data scientist is basically not a mathematician, not a statistician, but he amalgamates all these subjects and come to certain conclusion. So the basic definition, again I am repeating, data scientist is nothing but it is an interdisciplinary field that combines expertise from several domains. And a data scientist is a unicorn that needs to possess diverse skills of statistician, mathematicians, machine learning, operation research, data visualization, communication, and domain expertise. So how data science works? So on your screen, there's a diagram which gives a basic model how we work on data science. Okay. From real world, here it is real world, we generate certain amount of data. We collect collection of raw data, and we move it into a certain this particular portion. This is called as data pre-processing. This is the basic important portion where the overall data is to be taken. And after that, there's one basic requirement of data cleaning is to be done. Now, what is this data cleaning means? When we generate data, suppose if I am dealing with a college data, students will form, but there are certain absurd entries. So we have to manage those absurd entries by correcting or cleaning the data. That sort of thing is applied first. After cleaning the data, we move into the data selection feature, in which we have the operations like data filtering, data aggregation, or data querying. After this, we move into data processing feature. Now, this gives a view of analysis and visualization of data, how we want to look at into. There are, then we talk about different models and algorithms. we apply this analysis and visualization of data into these models and algorithms, and to generate certain reports, visualization of results, revisions, and we can give further on any aspect, and then decision making. And finally, this the data is used for decision making into real world again. So this is overall process we apply in data science. What key things data scientists do? They basically requirement designs. They start from this particular segment, experiment design, then statistical modeling and mathematics they do. Then after that, data mining is there, then domain research, and then finally, visualization is there. These are the processes they do often. Now, I'm coming to different tools. Since it is a mixed, basically, class of persons hearing this particular talk. So what sort of tools we use? I'm using basic, which I use and which I ask my student to follow up. Data scientists are use traditional statistical methodologies that form the core backbone of machine learning algorithms. So in term, I can say machine learning is a subset of data mining, data science. And they also use deep learning algorithms to generate robust predictions. So data scientists basically use the following tools and programming languages for handling data science. Mainly we use R, Python, SQL, Weka, Hadoop. There are n number others. I'm not going into more details. I'm explaining a little bit about these all. R programming, it is a scripting language that is specifically tailored for statistical computing. It is used for data analysis, statistical modeling. Earlier, it was basically used for statistical modeling. Now, we can use it for statistical modeling as well as time series predictions, forecasting, and clustering, etc. And R is mostly used for statistical operations, and it also possesses the feature of an object-oriented programming language as well. So it is an interpreter-based language, and it is widely popular across multiple industries. Then Python, it is the most popular language nowadays. Like R, Python is an interpreter-based high-level programming language. Python is a versatile language. It is mostly used for data science and software development. Python has gained popularity due to its ease of use and code readability. It is a open source available. As a result, Python is widely used for data analysis, NLP, natural language processing, computer vision, and it comes with various graphical and statistical packages like Matplotlib, NumPy, SciPy, and more advanced packages for deep learning, like TensorFlow, PyTorch, Keras, etc. For the purpose of data mining, wrangling, visualization, and developing a predictive model, we utilize Python. This makes Python a very robust language for this data science. Then comes SQL, which we used earlier. Data scientists use SQL for managing and querying data stored in database. For data cleaning, it is mostly used. Being able to extract information from database is the first step towards analyzing the data. Then relational databases are collection of data organized in tables. SQL is used for extracting, managing, and manipulating the data. Suppose someone is working in banking industry, he uses SQL for extracting information of customers depending upon certain criteria that is there. For if I am using it for examination and purpose in academic industry, so I'm using it for extracting information of either students or faculty or different papers, etc. So there are SQL, while relational databases are SQL. NoSQL is a popular choice for non-relational or distributed databases. Recently, NoSQL has been gaining popularity due to its flexible scalability, dynamic design, and open source nature, like MongoDB, we are using, Redis we are using, and Cassandra. These are the examples of NoSQL. Then another word which we are using nowadays frequently, it is Hadoop. Big data, it is another trending term that deals with management and storage of huge amount of data. Data can be either of structured in nature or unstructured. So a data scientist must have familiarity with the complex data and must know tools that regulate the storage of massive data sets. One such tool is Hadoop. While being open source software, Hadoop utilizes a distributed storage system using a model called as MapReduce. There are several packages in Hadoop, such as Apache Pig, Hive, HBase, etc. Due to its ability to process colossal data quickly, its scalable architecture and low cost development, Hadoop has grown the most popular. Then there's another tool which is called as Weka. For data scientists looking forward to getting familiar with machine learning in action, Weka is an ideal option. Weka is generally used for data mining, but also consists of various tools like tools for which are required for machine learning operations. And this is also an open source platform which uses graphical user interface. So it is easier for users to interact with or without requiring any line of code. So people don't have to write code. The persons who are not from a computer science background, basically those persons are using this Weka tool very frequently. Now, these tools are utilized in applications, various applications, and now I'm going to tell you about certain applications of data science. You're finding there are N segments in our life, from retail sector to logistics, from general outlook to healthcare, sports, finance, and anomaly detection and security. So data science in healthcare has been healthcare has been a topic of basically importance in our daily life. Data science has been playing a pivotal role in healthcare industry also. With the help of classification algorithm, doctors are able to detect cancer tumors at an early stage using image recognition software. Similarly, the diabetes prediction based on previous characteristics of patients. Yes. Hello.
During no issue, sir. Please continue, sir.
Yeah. It will take five, six minutes more. During this hard times of pandemic, COVID, genetic industries are using data science for analyzing and classifying patterns for genomic sequences. Various virtual assistants are also helping patients to resolve their physical and mental ailments. There are n number of areas in healthcare in which data science nowadays is utilized. Then e-commerce, Amazon uses recommender systems that recommends users for various products based on their historical purchases. Data scientists have developed recommendation systems, predict user preferences by using machine learning. Not only Amazon, Flipkart, and various other marketing sites are using these techniques. And just to know the behavior of customer, what are his likings and dislikings, these can be addressed by using data science in e-commerce. In manufacturing industry, also we are using data science, like industrial robots have taken over mundane and repetitive roles required in manufacturing units. Nowadays, there are paperless and no manual labor sort of industries are growing up also. These are using industrial robots, and these industrial robots are autonomous in nature, and they use data science technologies such as reinforcement learning and image recognition to follow the different instructions. In conversational agents, nowadays Alexa and Siri, these are common words which we see on our television screen. We know about Alexa, which is used by Apple, which uses speech recognition to understand users. Data scientists developed this speech recognition system that converts human speech into textual data. Also, it uses various machine learning algorithms to classify user queries and provide an appropriate responses. Similarly, data science can be used in transport also. Self-driving cars are used autonomous agents that utilize reinforcement learning and detection algorithms. Self-driving cars are no longer fictions due to advancement in data science. Along with that, Google Map, you will find in your last 6 months where you traveled, daily, how much you traveled by your vehicle or by on your foot, on your foot. These things are taken care of with the help of data science. Also, you can go into this Google Map thing, and you will check out for in past 1 year what you did in terms of travel. Another area which we are utilizing disaster management, where we are using this thing, and as well as sentiment analysis, we are also using for sentiment analysis, we are also using data science as a tool. Here are two graphs. One is here. This is disaster response today, the response and timely response. And here the second graph gives me disaster response of target when it comes, how we react and accordingly. Similarly, in this Twitter sentiment analysis, we take sentiments of different persons. We classify it depending upon the nature of data, and then we do data science to give validations about what things are happening at which point of time. This is all. And then since I have given just only half an hour, I'm giving certain concluding remarks. While data science is a vast subject, being an aggregate of several technologies and disciplines, it is possible to acquire these skills with the right approach. In the end, data science is a very robust field that best fits people who have a knack of experimentation and problem solving. It is available for all streams, all subjects. With a large number of applications, data science has become a most versatile career field for students as well. Thanks a lot. If there is any question, please, you can ask.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, due to lack of time, we will not take on. Now I would request to our respected principal, sir, Professor H.D. Sharma, to present their blessings and share his experience about the webinar. Principal, sir. Sir, over to you.
Sir, please unmute kar lijiye.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Dr. Deepak. The successful webinar, which is attended by more than 250 scholars around the various part of India. I'm not man of computer sciences, but will try to conclude this session in a way. In this knowledge era, information are very important. To know what others are doing in their respective field, data is important source. Without we could not think to live in 21st century. Data science has 5 data related operation. These are: data collection is the process of gathering data, storing data involves maintaining the collected data for use, processing, transformation and loading of data. Describing includes 2 aspects. One, the presentation of data with the help of graphs and other visualized, and data summarization with the help of statistics like mean, mode, median, standard deviation, variances, etc. And the fifth and last is modeling data distribution and making inference. Data science involves development of methods of recording, storing, analyzing data to effectively extract useful information. The goal of data science is to gain insights and knowledge from any type of data, both structured and unstructured. Therefore, data science is important for everybody whether you are in operations, academics, industries, banking, manufacturing, transport, commerce, education, for which we collect data from various sources to take appropriate decisions. But rightly said by, or mentioned by Dr. Ravi Bhatoria, who involves three V's, volume, variety, and velocity, means the data may be collected from various sources, but for taking better decision, appropriate decision, we should have the trustworthy data. So important part of it. I would like to thanks Dr. Ravi Bhatoria, my son-in-law, enlightened all of us about this subject, the practical approach of the subject, data science, and hope this academic association with Sri Janaran PG College will continue in future too. I would like to thank Dr. Puneet Mishra, the Assistant Professor, University of Lucknow, for its beautiful presentation, the knowledgeable presentation, and definitely a man of commerce like me. Today, may have some knowledge about the data science. I hope the such type of webinars will be organized by the Department of Computer Science again and again. And for their efforts, would like to congratulate both the Dr. Deepak Verma and the Amrendra Kumar Sharma for their continuous efforts from last so many days to organize the show. Once again, would like to congratulate the expert, to thanks to experts and the two pillars of the commerce, the computer science department, Dr. Deepak and Amrain, for their restless efforts to organize the show. Thank you. Thank you again to all.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now, I would request to Dr. Vijay Raj Srivastava to present the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak Verma, sir. Very, very thanks to everyone, all listeners, all viewers and participants. सबसे पहले मैं आभार प्रकट करता हूँ अपने महाविद्यालय के प्राचार्य प्रोफेसर एस डी शर्मा सर का कि सर आपने आज एक बहुत ही अच्छी डिबेट को, एक अच्छे डिस्कशन को, एक अच्छे सेशन को ऑर्गेनाइज करने का मौका दिया और बहुत ही दो खूबसूरत ब्यूटीफुल स्पीकर्स हमें दिए जिनसे सारी बातें आज हमें पता चली, विस्तार से पता चली। और उसके बाद मैं बहुत धन्यवाद दूंगा श्री रवि भदौरिया जी को जो कि डेटा साइंटिस्ट हैं और सेंट लुइस अमेरिका से हमारे साथ जुड़े। सर मैं अपने महाविद्यालय की तरफ से आपका बहुत आभार प्रकट करता हूं क्योंकि आपने अपने बहुत ही प्रीशियस टाइम इंटरवल से ये समय निकाला है। हमें पता है कि आपके प्रोफेशन में उस समय एक एक मिनट उस समय बहुत कीमती है जहाँ की पैंडेमिक से पूरा विश्व लड़ाई लड़ रहा है, आप अपने काम से जुड़े हुए, उसके बावजूद आपने हमारे स्टूडेंट्स के लिए ये समय निकाला। हम आपका हृदय से आभार प्रकट करते हैं। वी आर वेरी ग्रेटफुल टू यू सर। और आपने एक बहुत अच्छी बात कही कि लर्निंग जो है एक सस्टेनेबल प्रोसेस है और स्केलिंग किसी भी पूरे फॉर्मेट का, रिसर्च का और एक्सप्लोरेशन का बेस बनता है। स्केलिंग पे अगर थोड़ी सी मिस्टेक हो जाए तो हमें डेटा कलेक्ट करने में और फिर उसको एनालाइज करने में बहुत दिक्कत होती है। तो एक तो बहुत ही इंटेलिजेंट आस्पेक्ट है ये रिसर्च की ओर जाने का क्योंकि रिसर्चेज हमारे अब एक कॉमन लाइफ का आधार बनती जा रही है। हम सब कहीं ना कहीं फॉर्मल इनफॉर्मल रिसर्चेस से जुड़े रहते हैं। डेटा को साइंटिफिकली, रिसर्चेस को साइंटिफिकली कंडक्ट करने के लिए ये सारी चीजों के बेसिक इनपुट्स हैं जो आपने बताए। बहुत विस्तार से आपने हमें जानकारी दी। एक बार पुनः मैं आपका हृदय से आभार प्रकट करता हूँ। वी आर वेरी 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 मच ग्रेटफुल टू यू सर। डॉक्टर पुनीत मिश्रा सर को हम सभी काफी लंबे अरसे से जानते हैं और पुनीत मिश्रा सर की सहृदयता के लिए मैं उनको बहुत धन्यवाद देता हूँ। हमें जब भी हमारे महाविद्यालय को आपकी जरूरत पड़ी है, हमारे स्टूडेंट्स को आपकी जरूरत पड़ी है, आपने सहर्ष अपना समय हमारे साथ शेयर किया है और अपना नॉलेज इम्पार्ट किया है स्टूडेंट्स को। आज आपने बहुत अच्छी बातें बताई कि किस तरह से डेटा साइंस एक स्पेशल साइंस बन के उभरा है और इसमें बहुत सारे कॉम्बिनेशन है, मल्टीडिसिप्लिनरी जो नॉलेज है उसका एक अमलगनेशन है और इसका खुद का अपना एक स्पेशल रोल है। तो एक ये बहुत बड़ी बात है जो आपने आज बच्चों को बताई। कभी फिर से हम इस सेशन को एक बार और जब हमारे पास थोड़ा समय होगा तो हम इसको कंक्लूड करेंगे। मैं आपका हृदय से आभार प्रकट करता हूँ, हमारे महाविद्यालय के कंप्यूटर साइंस के डॉक्टर दीपक वर्मा जी और श्री अमरेंद्र वर्मा जी। बिल्कुल सर ने, जैसे प्रिंसिपल सर ने कहा कि आपके रेस्टलेस एफर्ट्स से ये चीजें संभव हो पाई हैं और आज हमें बड़ी प्रसन्नता है। आज हम जैसे लोग जो कि कंप्यूटर साइंस से जुड़े नहीं है, सिर्फ इसके एप्लीकेशन पर निर्भर हैं, लेकिन इसकी जरूरत हम लोग को सबसे ज्यादा है, जैसे सारी दुनिया को है। वसुधैव कुटुंबकम की जो भावना है, अगर ये इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी के बिना कम्प्लीट नहीं हो सकती, तो इसमें आपका योगदान है। और विभाग ने एक इतने अच्छे सेमिनार को ऑर्गेनाइज किया, आप लोगों ने बहुत मेहनत की है, आपको बहुत आभार, आपके जो स्टूडेंट्स, आपकी जो टीम आपके साथ थी, उन सभी को बहुत बहुत आभार। और हमारे महाविद्यालय के बहुत ही वरिष्ठ शिक्षक हमारे साथ जुड़े हुए हैं। सर, मैं आप सभी ऑनरेबल फैकल्टी मेंबर्स का हृदय से आभार प्रकट करता हूँ इस सेमिनार को अपनी उपस्थिति से सक्सेसफुल बनाने के लिए। और एक बार फिर मैं ज्यादा समय न लेते हुए अपने शब्दों को विराम देता हूँ, प्रिंसिपल सर से इस सेशन को ओवर करने की अनुमति चाहता हूँ। आप सभी को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। थैंक यू
विजय, थैंक यू टू ऑल।
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू। नमस्ते सर, नमस्ते श्री रवि भदौरिया सर, पुनीत मिश्रा सर, नमस्ते। थैंक यू
सर, थैंक यू सो मच सर,
थैंक यू।